Okay.
Yeah, so thank you very much. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers very much for inviting me. It's a very, I think, exciting conference, also an impressive environment here. So I'm very glad that I have the chance also to present my work here. So this talk will be also about expressibility of neural networks. We will look at very general neural networks, not specifically ConvNets, as in the talks before. And I'm particularly interested in understanding the relation. On the one hand, I would like to have maximal expressive power of neural networks, but on the other hand, I would like to limit their complexity in terms of sparse connectivity. And I'm also interested in minimizing, in some sense, the size of the weights so that I have minimal memory requirements for those. And in this regime, we will see that we can get an optimality result and we can explicitly construct those neural networks which meet this bound. And in the end, I would like to also show you some numerical results in this regime. And this is joint work with three of my colleagues, Helmut Bölsfrei from the ETH in Zurich, Philipp Groß from the University in Vienna, and one of my postdocs, Philipp Petersen from TU Berlin. So as it was said, I mean, I'm myself coming from mathematics. My background is imaging sciences, inverse problems, psychomotor analysis, contrast sensing. And so when I first heard about deep neural networks, I mean, I saw all these very impressive applications like AlphaGo and also self-driving cars. But then I saw that also in, let's say, areas more attributed to mathematics, deep learning has a huge impact. So let me mention some examples here. For instance, in imaging sciences, this classical problem of image denoising is now also approached by machine learning and deep learning techniques, and these algorithms meet the state of the art there. Also in the direction of theory or solvers of partial differential equations, there is, I think, very interesting work by my colleague from TU Berlin, Klaus Robert Müller, concerning the molecular Schrödinger equation. And then also in this whole area of inverse problems, if you go today to conferences in this area, more than 50% of the talks use already these methods, machine learning and deep learning. And I would like to show you one example we are also working on to show you which impact these methods now have on those products. So this is joint work with two of my colleagues from the Fraunhofer Heinrich Hertz Institute and one of my PhD students, Maximilian Merz. So in the endomorphy, if you have a body, you compute line integrals, and you have an angle which is missing, and it was always a huge problem with classical methods to, in a way, recover this angle. Now, with these methods of deep learning, what you see is that you can get maybe kind of a quantum leap there. So this is the original image. This is always enlarged. This is, let's say, a very crude recovery from these measurements, these line measurements which you take. Then if you do kind of the best methods which we know, sparse regularization using a particular representation system, in this sense shielded, you see, I mean, this what's called PSNR is already significantly increased. You see more details here. So I hope the screen is, resolution is not, yeah. So I hope you see that. I mean, the details are already much clearer, but then if you use deep neural networks and you also combine it with, let's say, more classical methods like shielded in a kind of smart way, then you get significantly improved images. You see this is much cleaner, a much better reconstruction than this. All these artifacts here have vanished. Yeah, so you see, I mean, these methods now have a huge impact also on those areas. But on the other hand, from my perspective as a mathematician, and therefore I'm always very excited to hear about theoretical results, there's still a need to develop some mathematical foundation. So, for instance, also in this area of inverse problems, developing a theory for deep neural networks for inverse problems, I mean, there's still a lot of ongoing work. And I wish I could tell you a complete theory, but I mean, this is still in the making. Good, so what I would like to focus on now is one of our theoretical results which we achieved in this area of expressibility. So, as in the previous talk, I would like to view a neural network as a way to approximate very complicated functions given sample values. And these functions, for instance, in imaging sciences, typically you assume that your image lies on a manifold. And if you would like to do classification, the function has finite output values, so you might want to approximate such a function. Or if you have more complex data, then maybe you don't have a manifold available, so you have your function defined on the Euclidean space, and also the output sequence. Maybe you have a sampled speech sequence, then your output is also in RF. And I would like to, as I said in the beginning, look at a very specific class of neural networks in a sense. So I'm interested now in networks which with sparse connectivity because of the efficiency of operation, but also concerning storage requirements. And also, this is in some sense one ingredient which was necessary for in speech recognition to be able so that these speech recognition systems now operate offline. So this is in some sense the key challenge we would like to tackle. On the one hand, we aim for high approximation accuracy. We want to send the expressive power of certain neural networks. But on the other hand, I would like to limit the complexity of those in terms of sparse connectivity. So in particular, I would like to tackle the following challenges. So first of all, we will discuss what is actually a meaningful notion of approximation. We will see that we need to be a bit careful there. We will then see that we have a lower bound on the sparsity of the connectivity, which we cannot go below, so every learning algorithm has to obey that. We'll see that we can explicitly construct neural networks which actually meet this bound, and then we'll see that in, let's say, reality, so if you train neural network with stochastic gradient descent, with certain network topologies, you get actually very close to this bound. Yeah, so that's the problem. Yeah, so let's start with fixing some notation and telling you how I see neural networks. So for me, D will be always the dimension of the input layer, L the number of layers and the number of neurons. I will denote activation functions by rho. F my linear maps will be W, so a neural network for me is a function from RD to RNL, where NL is later on always equal to 1. Which has this structure. And I will write phi is in NN, and I'm particularly interested in these parameters, so I'm interested in the number of layers. Well, the sparsity of the connectivity, so capital N is the number of edges with non-zero weight. The activation function, and I will also be interested in how the weights are bounded. So capital R will be a bound on the size of the weights. Good, so in this one, I have one very classical theorem, which I'm sure most of you know. This is the universal approximation theorem. It says if I have a continuous function defined on a compact domain, I have a nice activation function, which is not a polynomial, then for every accuracy I choose, I can find a neural network with one hidden layer, which approximates that function with that accuracy. So that's a very powerful result. It kind of says one size fits it all, but not really, because here we don't have any bound on the number of neurons. Yeah, so I mean, the accuracy could go down, but the number of neurons could blow up. But there is a better result by Pincus and Meyerhoff, and they showed, I might call this universal network theory, they showed that there exists a very nice activation function, so that the following holds. For every function, continuous function again on a compact domain, and every epsilon, I find a neural network now with two hidden layers, but these hidden layers are now of a fixed size. So the number of neurons does not depend on the accuracy. So I have a fixed size network, so that this network approximates F with an arbitrary accuracy. So that's a quite, I think, striking result. So the question is, what's the catch? Where are the catches in the weights? So the weights can be arbitrary enough. So we don't have any bounds there on the weights. So it could be, I mean, that things become impractical because the weights just block. So therefore, what I'm interested in is I would like to approximate functions by neural networks which are, in some sense, very efficient. So I would also like to control the size of the weights. And I would like to do it in this way. So let me walk through you through this definition. Let's assume I have my favorite function class, so here I will always work in L2 or D. So these are the functions my network wants to approximate. Then, please take a look here, I take an element out of my class, and I would like to approximate it with a neural network. And I'm interested in the sparsity of the connectivity, so capital N is now my number of connections. Also, this I would like to fix for the moment.
But I would like to have also the weights bounded. So this is the bound of the weights, and I would like to bound it polynomially in terms of m. Now, so n squared or n cubed, for instance. And also the number of layers I would like to bound. Now, so these are in some sense memory efficient neural networks, which I now approximate. Good, so I make an error for this particular n. And if I let n go to infinity, meaning I am allowed to take more and more connections, but still remaining in this memory efficient regime. And certainly then the error which I make will go down, and the rate at which it goes down, I call this effective approximation rate. Yeah, so it could be m to the minus 2, m to the minus 3, whatever. And taking this polynomial viewpoint is inspired by, say, older work by Lady Arnold from, well, more approximation in the sense of, in the spirit of image sciences. Good, so this is the viewpoint I would like to take. I would like to approximate with these memory efficient neural networks. So I would like to analyze the expressive power of neural networks in terms of this memory efficiency. Certainly, I mean, you're not the first to work in this area. There are many results. I apologize for every result, which is, I mean, every paper which I did not mention here. We just heard also, I think, very impressive results in the previous talk by Alan Churchwood. But I mean, none of these papers, to the best of my knowledge, analyzes, well, I mean, sparse connectivity and memory efficiency in terms of expressive power. Good, so what we first do, we would like to get the lower bound on the sparsity of the connectivity. How many edges do you actually need? And for that, we need to have a complexity measure for our class of functions. Now, I mean, it could be that the functions are quite complicated, so we need to understand, or we need to measure somehow how complex these functions are which you would like to express. And for information theory, and in particular weight distortion theory, there is something which is called the optimal exponent. So let me maybe just roughly say what it does. This is the precise definition, but maybe let's do it intuitively. So what happens is I take the class of functions, I map it to a bit sequence, and I map it back. So I encode it in a bit sequence. I will make an error, and this error will depend on the length of my bit sequence. Now if I let the error go to zero, the bit sequence will grow, and this optimal exponent will tell me how fast it grows. And so what I just said, everything, I mean, is encoded here. So this is the error which you make by encoding and decoding into a bit sequence. You have the bit lengths here, the size of the bits, of the bit stream, and then you have epsilon go to zero, and the rate is this m of c. Okay, so that tells me how complex my function class is, and certainly this will play a role in these results. So now let's look at the lower bound. Okay, so now we have our class of functions, again our C, and we take now a very abstract learning procedure. What does it do? Well, it takes an accuracy, it takes an element out of my class, and it outputs a neural network. And it outputs a neural network so that it approximates my class up to an error of epsilon. And also, I would like, as I said before, the weights of this network, I would like it to be bounded in a certain way. And then the question, how many edges, or how few edges can I take so that I can still achieve that? Now, can I let it say the number of edges go to zero? And here's the bound. So this is the number of edges of these neural networks. And what this says is there does not exist a constant, so that this is bounded by epsilon to minus gamma. Now, so this epsilon to minus gamma, this curve is a lower bound for the number of edges you need. You cannot go below that. Now, in fact, I mean, you cannot even bound it by a constant. So it's not an O of epsilon to minus gamma. So this gives me a lower bound. It tells me I need a certain number of edges. But now the question firmly is, can I meet this bound? And so you see, now if I let gamma grow, this curve will also grow, and at some point there might be a chance that I can construct explicitly networks which meet this bound. And so what is the first chance that this could happen? Well, if gamma is equal to this optimal exponent. So the question is, what happens in that case? And we will see that we can explicitly construct networks which are, in that sense, minimally sparsely connected. As a byproduct of this result, we just briefly mentioned, we can also see that this effective approximation rate is now actually bounded. Whereas with the classical approximation rate, it's almost the result by Bio of the Picos. That's not the case, but now this gives us, this tells us that this is also a meaningful notion of approximation. Okay, so we have a lower bound on the sparsity of the connectivity, which we want to meet. How do we do that? Okay, so these are the key ideas. What do people do in approximation theory? Well, I mean, they approximate function classes by combinations of elements of representation systems, wavelets, Fourier bases, whatever you can think of. Now I would like to take this concept and I would like to transfer it to the neural network setting. So I would like to mimic these by neural networks in a controlled way. And that way, we will explicitly construct neural networks which are, in that sense, optimal. Good, so let me add one slide with what this N-term approximation is. It's something actually quite simple, it looks maybe a bit complicated, but so we have our class of functions, and now here you have your favorite system. Fourier bases, wavelets, shielded, whatever you can think of. So what people then do is, they have a budget of M, and they are allowed to take a linear combination of those elements, and with this they approximate. That's called an M-term approximation. If this error is minimal, I call it the best M-term approximation, and I make an error. And then I let M go. Okay. So, but now what we want to do is we want to mimic what we do here. Because there, I mean, we have a lot of knowledge, we have a lot of results. Good. So how do we do this? Let's assume we have our favorite system, wavelets, for instance. Now I want to do the following. I take every element of my representation system and I would like a neural network which realizes that. So for every I assume there exists a neural network with a constant number of edges so that the functions are the same. So the function which the neural network gives me and this function which the element of the system gives me should be the same. So let's assume these little networks do that. For every element, I have a little network like this. Now I want to build an N-term approximation. So what do I do? Well, I put these networks next to each other. I combine the outputs. I put on the outputs these weights Ci. And then this network gives me this sum. So how many edges does it have? Well, M, O of M. Because you have constant number here, and here you have m edges. Good, so now the function class needs to come into play. So we have now our function class, and let's assume the system, well, I mean here, I have a neural network, this is from copied from the previous slide, but now assume my system is best for this function class, this is the optimal approximation rate. Then I claim every element of my class, I can approximate up to an error of epsilon with a network with that many edges. This is not difficult to prove, but it shows what we need. Yeah, this is copied from the slide before, but now you see if gamma is equal to gamma star, now we get a neural network where the number of edges is of the order of epsilon to minus gamma star. Yeah, so what is the, let's say, roadmap one needs to follow? We know something about the class of functions my network wants to express. Then I need a representation system so that I can realize every element with a network in a controlled way, and the system also gives me an optimal approximation. Now, so neural networks have as much expressive power as classical systems. There's a small catch. So if you listen closely, maybe you realize that we didn't say anything about the weights. Yeah, so this does not control yet the size of the weights, but we can actually extend this theory to also control the size of the weights, and I would like to now show you one very general example here where we can control the size of the weights as well. So now we will walk through this. And as a class of functions, we take what is in imaging science is called cartoon-like functions. We can do these as classification functions. These are functions which look like this. We have two areas which are bounded in this case by a term where discontinuity comes. So you can do this if a network needs to approximate this as a network which approximates, let's say, a classification function with two classes. For these functions, we know which representation system is optimal. So these are what's called alpha shielders. I will say something about this in a moment. We can compute the optimal exponent, and we know that these are the best systems for this function. Okay. So now what we need to do is we need to build all these elements of this system by a neural network. So let me briefly say what these alpha shielders are. So the elements of the system look like this. You have one function psi, and let me walk you through the parameters. So you have this parameter m. What does it do? You have the function, it moves it on the plane. That's the translation parameter. The second, the j, is the nullity-state parameter. It scales these functions in an anisotropic way. And also you have a parameter which changes the orientation. So this was a system which was designed in the area of imaging science. Now to realize that, you see, you have a huge advantage because this part here is already an affine linear map. So this you can realize by a one-layer network. So you just need to realize those sides. Now, I said alpha shielded, so we now slightly extend this. Instead of 2 to j half, we put an alpha here. And this ensures that also we include not only these shielded, but also wavelets and a lot of other which make the framework a bit broader. Cool. So now how do we realize this psi? That actually dates back to the PhD thesis of Jan Le Cun. So when I was there in New York, he told me already in his PhD thesis he had some, let's say, initial results on approximate certain functions, or realizing certain functions, and then this was extended by Sharon Kroninger and Kreuzmann. So if you have a redo, you can build a little lump function in this way. You can realize by a 2-layer network. Then you can build the 2D lump function that way, in this way. Then you can also shift it. And this way you get, this was work by Sharon Kroninger and Kreuzmann, you get what's called wavelets, which you can realize by a 3-layer network. We need to be a bit more sophisticated because with the redos, we had problems because they are not differentiable. But you can modify things and then you get these alpha-shielded generators. Good. And so now we work through this roadmap. We have a class of functions, we have representation systems which give you optimally fast approximations, and we can realize every element using your network.
By the way, there is some older results by Charles Michelli and Rushikesh Maskar on building.
Oh, very good.
Wavelets type things, so, yeah, in the 90s. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Good, so then we get this result, which shows that if we have our cartoon-like functions, so this function class, for every n, for every epsilon, we can construct a neural network. You see now we control the number of edges, and we also control the size of the weights, so that I get here an optimal approximation. Approximation rate. But you see, the advantage now is that also you limit, in some sense, the size of these networks. So one can say function classes which are optimal, representable by affine systems in general, by a very large class, which I didn't define precisely, but you can define very large class of functions. If they are optimally representable, then they are also optimally, efficiently, or effectively approximable by memory-efficient neural networks with the parallel path. So in that sense, these networks which you construct are in that sense optimal. Good. And you can also, as I said before, we are also interested in functions on manifolds, so you can extend this theory also to manifolds. And the last thing, let me show you also some numerical results. So now we were interested in, what happens in practice if you have trained a neural network. Do you get what relation between the approximation error and the number of values in the range. And for this we take particular architectures of this type, which also came out of the proofs. We now take ReLUs as activation functions we just learned to stochastic gradient descent, and we take very specific functions over which we have a lot of knowledge. And then we are interested in this connection. So the first function is a classification, just in two classes with a linear classifier. Yeah, so the neural network should learn this classification function, so we take our sample values, random sample values of this function, we train the neural network. And then what you see is that the number of edges which you have related to the error decays exponentially, and this is also what you expect from the theory to come out. Because here, for these type of functions, you know that what's called Richlets are the optimal systems, and they lead to this optimal, let's say, relation between the number of edges and the error. So here, the neural network learns exactly the best relation. Or the learned network expresses or exhibits the best relation which we have. Then you can ask the question, what happens in these little networks? Remember, these little networks were our elements of the representation system before. So what functions are learned there? And what you see, I mean, we found actually quite interesting is it automatically in these areas learns those functions which we know from the theory are the optimal functions, or approximately the optimal functions. And also learns this what we call Richlets in automatically. You can make it a bit more difficult. You can take, let's say, a classification where you not have a linear classification, but say a curve separating both areas. Then in that case, we know theoretically from our theory that in that sense, this relation between the number of edges and the error of m to the minus 1 is optimal, and in fact, the learned network also exhibits that. And again, in these linear networks, we learn also the optimal, approximately the optimal elements which we would also have chosen theoretically. These look kind of like shields, even in a multiscale way, so you can use them to put them together and even have something like a multiscale function. Good, so let me come to the end and conclude. So what interested me in this talk was the expressive power of neural networks, and I wanted to analyze the relation between the approximation accuracy which you can achieve, but at the same time limiting the complexity of the neural networks in terms of sparse connectivity and also concerning the size of the weights, so concerning in some sense memory efficiency. We saw that you can define or set up a reasonable notion for analyzing this effect, which is the effective approximation rate. We saw that we have a fundamental lower bound on the number of edges you need for that. We saw that you can explicitly construct neural networks which need this lower bound. And then we also saw that in practice, in numerical experiments with certain topologies, these networks which you learn also automatically come very close to this optimal bound which we got theoretically. So with this, I'd like to close and thank you.